Bless you and do you good. We are glad to be together again. We are coming to learn some more. Please share the link, share the video, start a watch party, welcome your friends so that we can learn together. Let us do this Bible study together. We may grow together. It is important for us to grow in the Word, because the main task in evangelism is discipleship. That's why Jesus saying that we need to reach out to other people. He say that we need to make disciples, not just convert people, but make disciples. Disciple, the word disciple just means students. Students who will learn the Word, students who will grow in the Word, students who will be able to teach others the Word. You see, when we disciple people, they know what they believe in. They know the God they believe in. They know the Christ who has saved them. They know the power of the Holy Spirit that worketh in them. And therefore, they're able to give an account to anyone who asks of why they believe. That's very important. And so, share with other people, especially new believers, your friends, even the ones who are not saved, so that they can hear what salvation is. Today we are going to look at a topic called, what is the way of salvation? What is the way of salvation? I will look at a few things in this topic that will help us to grow in the things of God. I am also learning as you learn. Thank you very much. Keep on sharing, keep on sharing, keep on sharing. Keep on sharing, and then we will say a prayer and we will delve into the topic for the day. Let us pray. Everlasting Father, King of Glory, we thank you that you created us with a purpose. And you gave us a mandate here on earth. And mighty God, our Father, we thank you because of the plan of salvation, because it rescued what had been destroyed by the sin when man fell, and when man was tempted by the devil, and put us back into track so that we can have dominion, we can rule here on earth, and we can do your will here on earth, and we can establish the kingdom as you had planned, as you had thought, and as you had wanted, mighty God. We thank you for Jesus Christ, your only begotten Son, whom you sent to die in our place. He became the substitute for us, so that he took our place and we took his place. That's why we are seated with him in the heavenly place, where he sits on the right hand of God, as co-heirs of the things of the kingdom of heaven, of this great salvation that you have given us. We thank you and we honor you that he did not refuse to die. He accepted and he died on our behalf. We receive that gift with thanksgiving. We glorify you and exalt you. We lift your name on high. In Jesus' mighty name. I want us now to go into a scripture in Philippians chapter 2. Very important. That's why I said last time we need to look at this chapter 2. And read it carefully. It has very profound things that we need to learn. Philippians 2, let's look at verse 12. This is Paul speaking to the church in Philippi. And he says this, "Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling." Amen. You see, we have a duty to work our own salvation. And today I want us to ask a few questions. We need to ask ourselves. We were saved, according to what we saw last time, from the wrath of God. But what is the purpose of God saving us? He did not just save us so that he doesn't have the wrath only. It is not just because he doesn't want to throw us into the lake of fire. Yes, that is one of the things we escaped immediately we got saved. But there is a greater purpose to why we were saved. Why God sent his son to die. Why God risked the life of his son without knowing. Of course he knows everything, but without knowing how people would respond. You see, even if people were not going to respond, God would have still sent the son. Why? So that he gives everybody an opportunity to choose a new way of life. A life with him forever and ever. And so that he doesn't condemn the whole world into the lake of fire without giving them a chance. Why am I saying this? It's because salvation is a choice. Salvation is not something given as a remedy by God by force. Salvation is something God gives to man, but man has to choose to accept the gift. You remember the analogy I gave last time? I gave an analogy of a person buying you a house. That person may buy a house, pay the full price, and bring you the keys. If you don't accept the gift, stretch forth your hand, receive the keys, then leave that place and go where the house is, and use the key to open, though the house is paid for, though the house is bought, though the house bears your name, you will never enjoy occupying it, living in it, using it for your own preservation, for your own activities. You will not use it for your own relaxation because you have not accepted the gift. The gift is bought. The gift has been paid for. The gift has been handed over to you, but you have not stretched forth your hand to receive it. So salvation is a gift given by God that must be received by choice by men. And that's why we also talk about something called predestined, that God knows everybody who will respond positively to the gift of salvation. And he knows the number that will enter heaven. He also knows the number that will enter into the lake of fire. And if that is not true, then God cannot be God, because God is omniscient. He knows everything. He knows absolutely everything. He knows this, the millisecond Jesus will step out of heaven to come the second time. He knows how many people will be found still holding on to the faith. He knows how many people will have died in faith, but he does not interfere with your choice. So he knows because he knows what you will choose. It's not because he has chosen for you. He still hopes that you can change your mind. He still hopes you can soften your heart. He still hopes you'll accept his way of salvation. So why are we saved? We want to look at the way of salvation, but I want to ask this question first. Why are we saved? Are we saved so that we can go to heaven? Are we saved so that we can reign and rule with Christ Jesus? Are we saved so that we can avoid hell? Yes, that is part of why we are saved. But that is not the full purpose of God in salvation. God gave us salvation so that he can build an army for himself that will do the will of God, the Father here on earth, that will actualize the kingdom of God on earth, that will represent God on earth, that will become ambassadors of his kingdom here on earth. And he has given us not just that responsibility, he has given us the mandate to do it. He has given us the power to do it through the power of the Holy Spirit. And I want to tell you, when you get saved, we get mesmerized by a few things, miracles, signs, wonders. But we need to grow beyond there, that we are not mesmerized by signs, wonders, and miracles, because it should become a way of life. You see, supernatural becomes a way of life when you leave your natural sin nature and become a supernatural being through the birth in the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. So God has a bigger plan. God is looking for an agent he can work with. And when we go to the doctrine of the church, we will see what the church is. Because God is looking for agents who will run his show here on earth. And that tells you, when he chooses us to become that group of agents, it means he knows we can defeat the demons. He knows we can defeat the devil. He knows we can defeat all the agents of the enemy, be it witches, be it spiritual beings, be it anything. He has given us power. That's why when Jesus was commissioning the church to go out and preach, talking to the disciples, he told them that all power and authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, and I send therefore. When you read from the Greek Bible, it means I send you therefore, as God sent me with that authority to accomplish these things for me on earth. Amen. So you're not a weakling. You are not just another person. You are not someone who is at the mercies of all the other people. You are not someone who can be blown by the wind of doctrine and temptation and fall. You are an empowered son of the living God. You are a Christian. Demons should not threaten you. Actually, if you know who you are and whose you are, demons should tremble, should fear when you walk into a place. I've heard of a testimony of a pastor in Nigeria who was told that a madman walked into the vehicle he was traveling in. And he said, I should not be worried about this madman, because me and the devils cannot share the same space. So it is the demon in the person that needs to be scared that it has walked in to a vehicle that I am in. And you know, when he finished saying that word, the demon that was oppressing the man just left him. Deliverance happened without the man even praying. When you know who you are, you become like Peter the apostle, who walked along the roads and his shadow fell on the sick people and it healed him. I want to declare to you today, when you mature in the things of God, you do not need to call your pastor when there is a sick person in your house. You just need to rise up in the authority Christ has given you and deal with the situation. That's why we need to disciple ourselves. We need to grow in the things of God so that we can stamp the authority of God on earth. We can let the enemy know who is the boss. You see, man was created to have dominion on earth. The devil was not given any mandate on the earth. He's a trespasser here on earth. Demons are trespassers here on earth. The fallen angels are trespassers here on earth. The evil spirits are trespassers here on earth. We are the owners of the earth because it was given to us. We are the custodians of God's authority and power now. And we need to start taking authority and power. We need to start moving in a way that God will approve, because everywhere we go, we do good. You see, the Bible says in Acts chapter 10 that how God anointed Christ, that he did good wherever he went and healed all manner of sicknesses. We need to take our position. So I will look at that when I'm dealing with the doctrine of the church, because the church is the agent of God through the power of the Holy Spirit to establish God's authority on earth. We are supposed to decree We are supposed to pull down, we are supposed to uproot, and we are supposed to erect structures of God here on earth. But because we have not worked hard to know ourselves, know our God, we are failing. The Bible says in Daniel chapter 11, verse 32, that the people who know their God shall be strong. They shall do exploits. We are the people. We need to know our God. We need to know our God-given authority and power and use it. So what is the way of salvation? Let me ask you a few questions. Are you hungry? Not physically hungry, but do you have a hunger for something more in life? There's a song we used to sing in the 90s, I think it was around 95, when there was a revival in Pensacola in the USA, that used to say, there must be more. And I think for me, I am believing with God now, there must be more. We must have more. This cannot be all God envisaged when he thought of salvation, when he thought of rescuing man, when he thought of man having dominion. Is there something deep inside of you that never seems to be satisfied with what you're seeing right now, what you're feeling right now, what you're going through right now? If so, Jesus is the way. If so, Jesus said, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never thirst. John 6:35. We need to be very, very careful. We need to have this hunger. When Jesus was speaking to the disciples and the multitude that came to him beside a hill when he was giving the Beatitudes, and Beatitudes starts from Matthew chapter 5, where the line I want to use is, and all the way to chapter 7. Those are the Beatitudes. Jesus talked about many principles of life. I want to take one because of what I'm talking about right now. Jesus said this, blessed are they that hunger and thirst for righteousness. If you hunger for these things, if you are not satisfied with how things are, God will feed you, because Jesus is the bread of life. Ask another question. Are you confused? Can you never seem to find a path or purpose in life? That's what I was talking about. Because sometimes you get saved and you ask yourself, am I just saved to be going to church? Am I saved just to be singing a few songs and praying? Am I saved just to worship God and that's all there is? Do you seem to have that kind of thing? You're looking for a purpose for this life that you have found in Christ? Does it seem like someone has turned out the lights and you cannot find the switch? If so, Jesus is the way of salvation. Jesus proclaimed, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life in him. John 8 verse 12. So today, that is the way of salvation. Let's look at another thing. Do you ever feel like you are locked out of life? You know, sometimes when we were younger, the kind of gospel that was preached was a bit confusing, because we were told, come to Jesus and everything will be all right. Everything will become good. And then you get saved and you realize that's when the battles begin. That's when demons have an issue with you. That's when sicknesses are sent to you to try and discourage you. That's why temptation ran to you. And then you start asking yourself, well, are those people who are telling us to get saved and everything will be okay really telling us the truth? And I think many people might have backslidden because what they were promised they never saw. Have you tried so many doors only to find that what is behind them is empty and meaningless in this life? Have you tried a career? Have you tried a course? Have you tried a school? Have you tried a business? Have you tried to start a family, and you thought, now once I do that, I'll have everything? And then you realize there is emptiness. It doesn't fulfill you any longer. Are you looking for an entrance into a fulfilling life? If so, Jesus is the way of salvation. And Jesus declared this: I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pastures. John 10:9. And he also said in John 10:10 that the thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but I have come to give you life, and life more abundantly. I know there are some people who pray the sinner's prayer, and now they're asking themselves, is this the life in abundance? Is this all there is? I want to declare to you today, there is more in salvation than just what we are experiencing right now. Sometimes we ask ourselves, we have left our families, especially for us who come from different religions, and you realize once you get saved, you can't go back to them. They might even kill you. And then now your question is, I go to church, I don't see the love, people are divided, people are factioned into different groups and societies, and they only meet in their cliques and all that, and there's no love, there's no embracing new people, there's no helping one another. Like when you read the book of Acts, especially, you look at chapter 4, it talks of people sold their properties and brought the monies to the feet of the apostles, and the needs of the people in the church were met, and no one of them lacked any good thing because their needs were met. And you're asking yourself, am I sure that this is all there is to the church? I want to declare to you there is more. Do other people always let you down? Have your relationships been shallow and empty? Does it seem like everyone is trying to take advantage of you in life? If so, Jesus is the way. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. John 10 and verse 11 to 14 and 14. If you have been let down, I want to declare there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother, and that is Jesus Christ. If you want to enjoy the wholesomeness of the things of God, if you want to find the purpose for life, you need to have a relationship, committed relationship with Jesus Christ. You need to know him. You need to understand him. You need to love him. And you need to allow him to love you back. Do you know, sometimes because of the things we have done in life, we feel like God will not love us completely. He will not forgive us completely. We always feel guilty. Let me tell you something. True love drives away fear. Amen. True love drives away fear. You need to allow God to love you. You need to allow God to release himself to you. You need to allow God to touch you in a way only he can touch you. You need to trust God when he says he will forgive you, or he has forgiven you, because God does not lie. And are you willing to become a vessel in his hands so that he can do the work he wants to do through you? Do you know that sometimes we have become too self-conscious that we have forgotten to be God-conscious? Do you realize we have become performance instead of people who allow God to act and to perform? Do you realize, even for us who are preachers, we have become actors before this theater, and we are worried more about what people will think when we preach, when we teach, when we pray for people. We need to forget about ourselves and be like John and say that he may increase and I decrease. That it is not my reputation online, it is God's reputation online. That it is not about me, it's about him. That I will rush with him wherever he wants to send me. That I'm willing to lay down my life, even to die, if he's sending me to that place that cannot be open for people to go. But right now we worry more about ourselves. We worry more about what people will do. We worry more about what people will say. We worry more about what will happen to me. You know, the Bible says, if we love our lives, we will lose it. But if we lose our lives for his sake, then we will find it. We need to sacrifice ourselves. I look at the missionaries who came all over the world, from especially Europe. They went to the US, they came to Africa, they went to the Middle East, they went to the Amazon, the jungles of South America. Some were killed on arrival. Some died of tropical diseases, but you know they were willing to die for Christ. And do you know that is a seed we enjoy today? Do you know that's why we are seated here today? Do you know that's why the church is here in Africa? Because men and women risked their lives. We're told of a single man who knelt down and prayed and cried like John Knox, who told God, "Give me Scotland or I will die." He prayed so hard and rocked on the position of kneeling that he dug the floor made of cement where his knees were rocking. It is said by the end of his life, his knees were like camel's knees because the skin had become so hard. The skin had become so, wasted. But you know, after he died, then the revival came. The revival came to Scotland. The revival happened when this man prayed. It is amazing that he never even saw the revival. Don't pray prayers that are selfish, that I want the revival, but you're praying that the revival will come and you must be the one who experiences it. You are the one who sees it. You're the one who ushers it in. Can you just do the will of God, even if you don't see the reward? Generations to come will see it. Your children will enjoy it. Your family will enjoy it, even if you don't see it. Hallelujah. Let me ask another question. Do you wonder what happens after this life? Is there any other life? Are you tired of living your life for things that only rot or rust? Can you have a purpose beyond making wealth and becoming rich? Do you want things above and not things below? And I'm not saying being wealthy is wrong, because even the gospel requires wealth, requires support. The missionaries who came to Africa were sent by their churches. They were given their monthly allowances. They were given their upkeep. They were given their travel to Africa and back for furlough to rest and to raise more funds. The church in America has supported the gospel all over the world. It is because they had money. It's because they had wealth. But we can't live for the wealth. We can't live for the money. We can't live for things. We are not living for houses. We are not living for cars. We are living for God's will and purposes here on earth? Do you sometimes doubt whether life has any meaning? Do you want to live after you die from this side of the earth? If so, Jesus is the way of salvation. Jesus declared, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die." John 11, 25 and 26. Do you want to know that life? Do you want to know that way? In conclusion, what is the way? What is the truth? What is the life? Jesus answered, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." John 14 and verse 6. Want to declare to you today, the way of salvation is Jesus. The truth of salvation is Jesus. The life in salvation is Jesus. Jesus is the center. Jesus is the beginning. Jesus is the end. He was in the beginning. He created everything. Center, he came and died for his creation. And at the end, he's coming back again for his creation. Are you waiting for him? Are you looking forward to receiving him? Hallelujah. I beseech you, brothers, if all those questions I've asked this evening are part of some of the questions you have, you need to find Christ Jesus. You need him to give you the truth. You need him to become your way. You need him to give you life. If you want to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I want you to pray this prayer after me and say, "Heavenly Father, I'm a sinner. I cannot save myself. No acts of goodness can save me. Money cannot save me. Family cannot save me. Even a government cannot save me. But you have given a way out for me to be saved. Jesus Christ, your Son, who accepted to take my sin and to die my death, and who was buried, and on a third day he rose again. Today he is seated at the right hand of God the Father, stretching out his hands, giving me eternal life, which is a free gift given out of grace to me. I accept the gift. I accept the way of salvation, who is Jesus Christ. And I ask him to forgive me of all my sins, and to wash me with his precious blood and the water that came from his side. Thank you for forgiving my sins, and thank you for washing away my sins. I am as white as snow now. I stand right before you, and I know you will receive me. When I die or Christ comes, then I will be taken to heaven. I will enjoy the Lamb's Supper with him, drink the wine with him again and fellowship with him. And then I will come back with him to reign and rule for 1,000 years. Thank you that my sin was judged in the body of Christ. And now I stand before you righteous and holy. I thank you and I honor you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. The Lord bless you. The Lord increase you. The Lord do you good. The Lord see you through this evening. May the Lord bless you in everything you do and say, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I want to thank those who have been with me. I see Stephen Kimanthi. Thank you for joining me this evening. God bless you. I see Prophetess Ruth Kioko, my prophet, my friend. Thank you for joining me. I see Irene Kathoni, Karen. God bless you for joining me this evening. May the goodness of the Lord fill your life, fill your home, touch your people. In Jesus' mighty name. See you on Thursday. God bless you. And God increase you. God do you good. In Jesus' mighty name.